Good evening, ladies as well as gentlemen. Papa Boris here, playing some more Pathfinder adventures. This is the third scenario of the fourth adventure called the Black Tower, and I don't know how other people feel, but this is one of my favorite scenarios in the whole game. Not only do I think it has some pretty cool stuff going on, but it also has one of the best loot cards in the whole game, as a reward, the Emerald Codex. It's the only reward, but it's a really sweet one, so I'm very excited about that, and of course to play with it in the next two scenarios. Anyway, let's go ahead and go over the rules here. So in this scenario, at the beginning, each location deck starts with an extra spell, which is really cool because it's good, gives you more spells to find, lets you have an extra chance of finding some of those sweet new Adventure Deck 4 spells, but of course it's also an extra card to explore through, so it's good, but it also makes the scenario harder. Harpies are a little bit harder in this scenario, which of course makes sense because they are the henchmen. And then there's this other rule here, which is that when you acquire a spell, you have to bury a card from your hand. Now, typically, you know, if you pick up a spell, you can just bury it right away. So it's not like a net loss, necessarily. You're not any worse off than you were before you picked up the spell. But of course, it makes it harder to use the spells that you just picked up, because if you do pick one up and want to use it in that scenario, you have to bury something else. So it can be a very annoying thing. Well, as we've seen for the heroic playthrough, anything that requires you to bury cards is going to potentially be very annoying. Okay, anyway, let's go ahead and start this thing. Now, for the villain... Oh, yes, right. There's the this is the dialogue. Ooh, it's Linny talking. Look at these grinning gargoyles. Hey, be careful, an incredible treasure. Yes, maybe it will. Okay, that's right. So it's very thematic here. We're looking for some treasure, and boy, do we find it. All right, I like right away the fact that all the locations are on one screen. That's... Actually, are they? I don't know. We'll see. They sometimes start off on all-in-one screen, but then you have to scroll around more to see them. Anyway, this is a pretty tricky one. So the combat check is actually not as high as the previous villain. He does have some immunities that typically aren't going to matter. The mental thing stops, like, some evasion effects from working. But then the meat of him is, of course, this little bit right here. Every character at the location has to make a pretty tough Fortitude or Constitution check, or else the difficulty of their checks is increased by 4. So you figure most characters are going to fail this, so he's really like a combat 24, which is a little bit harder than the previous villain, but he's also got some immunities, a pretty nasty if undefeated effect, and if you continue going after fighting him, your turn is going to be more difficult, although that's not very likely. However, if you can make this really crazy check, you actually get a nice bonus to beat him, essentially a 20 instead of a 24. And the Harpies, remember, their difficulty is increased by 2 as a special rule for this scenario. And this is... I imagine this must have been a real pain in ye olde butox to program. But basically, whenever you encounter one of these, every single character in the party, not just the person fighting them or everybody at the location, but everybody, needs to make a Wisdom 8 check, or they cannot play spells or weapons, and if they fail this check, they get sucked to the location of the person who found the Harpy Monk, which can cause some problems later on if you're temp closing or if you encounter something that affects everybody at the location. So these Harpies basically draw everybody in. Now, in my party, excuse me, there's a couple of characters who can actually make these checks. So Linny, I think, auto-succeeds at a Wisdom 8 check, and Scylla has a decent shot if she wants to throw an extra d6 down against on top of her d8. And then Harsk sucks. He's just got a d6 for it. Yeah, so it's really just those two who might make it, but pretty much everyone else is just going to keep getting sucked around. A Wisdom 8 check is actually pretty tough, even though it's a small number. It's actually pretty difficult to make without spending resources that you pretty much don't want to spend. Okay, so anyway, the other problem, of course, with those harpies is that when Ezrin finds them, he can't really attack them, so you have to make sure that he can make that check. Okay, so here what I'm going to do is I'm going to see what is the most... Well, hang on, let's do some simple stuff first. So, the Academy is definitely Ezrin's jam, and the Temple is always Linny's jam, because she likes to explore a lot and pick up blessings, so that's pretty easy. We have a new location here, the Courtyard. No, this is not new, this is in every freaking scenario. God, I hate this place. Alright, well, Mariziel's gonna go here, try to take that out real quick. I'm gonna have Scylla start in the deeper dungeons, although she's not gonna stay there. I wanna start there so that in case she draws Augury in her opening hand, she can use Augury on this place. It's like the best place here to use Augury on. And then I'm gonna start a Miri there, just in case Scylla doesn't get a weapon in her opening hand. I guess I might as well keep doing that. Scylla's probably gonna go to the city gate, and maybe a Miri will go to the mountain peak. I'm not sure. We'll see. Harsk needs to go somewhere. Harsk does not want to fight bandit henchmen at the start of his turn. He sucks at charisma. I guess I could go to the city gate with Harsk. I could actually have Harsk go to the mountain peak and just try to. Yeah, his survival is just like a D6 plus 2, so he's not very good at avoiding that, so it's probably not good for him to go there. I could actually have Amiri stay in the deeper dungeons, have Scylla fight bandit henchmen here, and then have Harsk go to the city gate. Let's try this. Because Scylla doesn't actually mind fighting those bandits. She can take them down pretty well. She can make the strength 5 check, and she actually likes being in a location that doesn't have too many monsters in it because it gives her more meat from her scouting power, more extra explorations. Okay, so anyway, let's go ahead and do this. I think the order's fine. I guess maybe for this scenario. Oh, excuse me, I have a cold. For this scenario, it might have been okay to have Ezreal go first because there's 6 spells of that academy. All right, Scylla did actually get Augury, and on top of that, she did not get a weapon, so let's go ahead and give her something good. Oh, how about, goodness. How about this bastard sword? I'm not actually sure what is the best thing. What, okay. Track card onto portrait. Hello? Oh my god. This interface. I swear, the interface just got worse. Okay, I can't select it. I can't drag it here. Can I drag it there? Can I drag it? Like, how exacting is this? Maybe I just can't do the bastard sword? How about the scythe? Will the gods accept an Impaler of Thorns? No, okay. Yeah, that's a pretty bad bug. Wait, are they not? Yeah, they're at the same location. She's got the marking indicating that she's in the same spot. And of course, her portrait is appearing. Oh, alright, it worked that time. Alright, thanks, game. So generous of you. Anyway, let's go ahead and cast Augury, which is the same location Amiri is at. See if we can get rid of a monster. Oh, Slashing Blade. Well, I'm glad that we did Augury. Now there's a 50-50 chance the Slashing Blade will be underneath the henchman. Because that's just annoying. That's the dexterity one that everybody has to make. I'm gonna go ahead and flip a card here. Because Augury, I think, is worth finding, and Scylla might get back around to the beginning of her deck if this is the first card that she plays. Excuse me. Alright, so Amiri, let's go ahead and. Hey! It's a Harpy Monk. Okay, so what's gonna happen is Amiri's gonna have to either make this wisdom check or just bare fist the monk. The thing is, her bare fisting abilities are pretty good. And if I spend resources to make the wisdom check, I might as well spend those on the bear fisting. So now everybody in the party's got to make this checks. For the most part, it doesn't really matter that much because most people are not going to want to play weapons or spells. Now, Ezrin, oh geez. Well, let's see. Was there anything that he would have wanted to play? Actually, he doesn't have any of his helping spells or anything. So yeah, I guess he'll just fail this. I don't really see any value to Ezrin making this. He'll, of course, get sucked over to the location and then have to walk back to the academy. Mariziel is fine. Oh, well, there is one annoying thing. Harsk, if he gets sucked over, he can't use his hero power to help anyone's checks with the harpies. Now, for Linnea, it's actually pretty important she makes it because she doesn't want to have to pay a card to go back to the temple. Luckily, she auto succeeds at wisdom checks. And for Harsk, I've got to really decide if it's worth trying to, help him make it. Wait a minute. This is weird. Hang on. How come Ezreal's allowed to play Sagacity? This is a spell, right? And he failed his check already. And it says that the character may not play weapon or spells. That's weird. Well, I'm gonna try this because I think it would be nice. God darn it. This interface. It would be nice if Harsk could succeed at staying put so that he could play his sniper shots. So here we'll use. Oh, God. The game just might have crashed. Recharge this card to add a D4 to any check by a character at your location. Oh no, it didn't crash. It's just the card is right there. It freezes anywhere on the screen. Oh, this is cool. Oh, there's like a die popping in. Oh, this is good stuff. This is solid programming. Yeah, I mean, as soon as you see what the Harpy Monk does and the trouble that Obsidian's had with other things like the Wand of Enervation and the Goblin War Chanter, it's like, oh god, this must have been a nightmare. Anyway, I want to go ahead and press the X. See if we can maybe play it now. Oh, it actually worked the second time. All right, well, see, I got to get a 5 on these. How badly do I want it? I'd have to spend a real resource here because I don't have any of the rechargeable blessings. Nothing matches the current top blessing. So 5 on those two, with 3.5 plus 2.5 is 6. Yeah, it's not guaranteed to get that 5. So how much does Harsk care about staying put? Nah, not that much. I'm just gonna roll it and see what happens. All right, we fail. So he's not gonna get to do sniper shots, which is unfortunate because that would have been a good way to help Amiri win. But let's see. So first of all, she's gonna bury a card here. Let's go ahead and bury the. Oh gosh, the scythe is better than the impaler, but the impaler is cool because it's got. Well, no, the impaler has a plus two, but the scythe is an extra die plus one. So yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and just bury the impaler. We'll call this a day. I lose the ability to reroll, but that's fine. So that's that. And then anybody got any actual things to help with melee combat? Ezreal is lit up, although I don't know why, because he doesn't have anything that he can contribute here. Wait, what? This is weird. Wait, how come Harsk is allowed to shoot a sniper shot? He shouldn't be allowed to because he got sucked over, didn't he? Didn't Harsk get sucked over to this location? I mean, I feel like if I actually do this, I'm going to be tempting fate just by having the game explode. All right, so we're gonna have Mariziel just like play a blessing, or no, that's a good one to save for later. Let's have Scylla play a blessing. Yeah, we'll do this blessing of Aurori. God, I hate that you cannot. There's no buttons anymore for this shit. All right, so let's go ahead and do this. Let's see, I need to roll a 10 on those three dice. Should be fine. So let's roll them. Oh boy, that was close. Maybe I should have played another blessing. Oh, I'm working on the daily challenge here. Look at that. All right, so now Constitution or Fortitude. Oh crap, did I just use my Constitution Blessing? Okay, no. Whew, good. So we're gonna get a 3d8 here, although I think I do wanna bury something else, maybe? No, I don't wanna bury. I'd rather just play the Blessing. Yeah, I wanna play this raw just to make sure we make this a failure here. It'd be really bad because the location is totally filled with cards. Okay, so that was a little bit hairy, but on the flip side, we now closed one location on the first turn. This is a pretty good streak I've had going, and Amiri can at least pull Scylla away somewhere so that Scylla can get some scouting done. Let's go ahead and go here. No one's going to be at the throne room for a while, so let's pull Scylla over, get a scouting bit of scouting done, and then see where. And then Scylla is going to have her next turn, so she's going to go to the bandit or the guard tower next. Okay, we're auto succeeding at the recharge here. Need an 8, got a plus 8 myself. Samiri draws into some weapons. Scylla does her scouting. Mammoth. Ooh, alright, that's a big fatty. Alright, I think we can move away now. Go to this bandit tower. Guard tower, excuse me. I call it the bandit tower because you have to fight bandits there. Anyway, let's explore. Oh my god. Well, buttermilk pancakes. You know what? We're doing it. Let's go for this. So I am gonna try to actually make this wisdom check so that I can play my weapon. And I'm gonna discard my armor here. Hello? Okay. Oh, it's to your combat check. Oh, well, that's fine. We'll just do that on the combat check then if I fail this check. Ah, shoot. Maybe that wasn't smart though, because now I'd have to spend a real resource. Is it worth spending a blessing to let her use a weapon versus just spending the blessing when she does the fight barehanded? Yeah, I think we'll just roll this. We'll just YOLO this right here and see what happens. Okay, so we got to have our cake and eat it. We saved our resources and we get to use a weapon. Now, everyone's gonna get pulled over to this guard tower. I think though that when it's closed, you don't actually have to fight the bandit henchmen, although I am not 100% positive on that point. So it's possible that everyone's gonna be. Oh my god, I'm an idiot. Did Linny just. She has a Staff of Heaven and Earth. How did this happen? Oh no. The whole reason I gave her an item card feat was to give her one of those orbs. Does that mean that I threw the orb away? Oh god, I threw an orb away. I'm a friggin' idiot. Yeah, this thing's terrible. Hate this card. So, crap. The whole reason I gave her an item card feat was to give her one of those. Let her keep one of those orbs. And I totally just failed to do that. Wow. Alright then. Well, crud. So, oh yes, Amiri will also have to get sucked away. Being sucked away isn't always bad. If everybody's sitting at the closed location, it's not necessarily a bad thing because then if somebody finds one of those, barrier cards where everybody at an open location has to fight, all the people who got sucked away to the closed location don't have to fight, and that can be a pretty significant boost sometimes. I don't know why Ezreal's lit up. It's continuing to not be a real thing. Let's go ahead and flip a card. Now, do I want to pop this Legion armor here? I need to roll a 9 on these dice. You know what? We're just going to do this. Whatever. I can heal later on. That's fine. So now we're just about guaranteed. Need a 9 on those 4 dice. Should be okay. That was a bit close. And now I think she auto succeeds because she has put 4 skill feats into strength. Yep, this just shows why, you know, if you got like, if these closing locations got just like a little bit harder, it would definitely have an impact on the game and just make things a little bit less trivial at some point. Banish a card from your hand to draw a random new ally. So I could banish Eloquence, which would then let me pick up a spell at the end of the scenario other than Eloquence. The problem is, this scenario is chock filled with spells, so we're gonna find other spells, so he might get stuck with crap, so I'm not gonna use that closing power. And there's nothing to do at the end of the turn. Okay, no, don't have to fight the bandit henchman, so that's good. So Ezrin, back to the academy. Oh man, how long have I been keeping up that streak where my first 2 turns I closed 2 locations? That's pretty sweet. Anyway, let's see, we got our Wand of Scorching Ray. Now this is a magic thing, so if I pick it up, I do get an extra exploration. However, the Academy is already going to give me an extra exploration because this is not a spell, and extra explorations don't stack. So if I pick this up, I will not get 2 extra explorations, I'll only get 1. All this is by way of saying I should not spend resources picking this thing up to avoid the 1 in 12 possibility of rolling a 1 because I'm getting an extra explore regardless. All right, this is an auto pickup. It's not good enough to keep, I don't think. Well, it's probably better than Acid Arrow, so I probably will keep it. So let's see, what do I want to bury? I'm going to bury invisibility. I don't think I'm ever going to use this, so we'll just bury that. And then we get an extra explore because we picked up a spell. Get a Harvey Monk. Oh, buttermilk pancakes. Well, the problem is there's 5 spells left at this academy that, okay, there's 2 problems. Number one, there's 5 spells left in this academy that I'm not going to get to see. So I'm going to have to decide right now whether I want to neglect to close this location after fighting this harpy. Also, had I kept my invisibility, I could have evaded the harpy and maybe kept on exploring, although I don't have my haste, so no, I could not have kept on exploring. So I have to decide if, you know, if I want to go risky with this scenario. I guess I have closed 2 locations already, so maybe it is worth it to just explore the rest of the way through the academy as Ezrin. But on top of that, we also have to actually beat this harpy, which is going to be difficult because I have to decide whether I want to bare fist her or actually try to get spells. Now, what's interesting is I could use this Wand of Scorching Ray that I picked up. Yes, I think that's going to be it. Why don't we just not spend resources on it on this wisdom check? Oh my god, I rolled an 8. Well, okay, so I'm going to get to use spells. But what I was thinking about doing was just using that Wand of Scorching Ray, and maybe someone plays a blessing, and then we call it a day. Man, the temple in this scenario is so annoying because if somebody goes to the temple and anybody else finds one of these harpies, then the person at the temple, if they can't make that wisdom check, they get sucked away. And when they get sucked away, they have to pay a card if they want to go back to the temple. So it's actually really bad. Also, oh Jesus, when the person who is at the temple finds the henchman, everybody else needs to discard a card moving into the temple. That's something I was not thinking about. That maybe means that my strategy of like starting at the temple as Linny is not good because once she finds that henchman, it's going to be bad. Does she have her Medusa's mask? She does not. Damn, that's going to suck. Anyway, why don't we just use Lightning Bolt here, my best spell? Because I need a 10 on these dice. That should be fine. So we'll just roll here. Yep, got a little bit of a margin going. So let's recharge this. And I have to really think, you know, whether I want to close this location. Actually, wait, I don't get to choose, do I? Because in this. Oh no, you have an option. It'll let you choose whether to close the location or not. So I auto succeeds it if I do choose to close it, but I am forfeiting 5 spells at the academy. I mean, Ezrin could just sit at the academy for the rest of the scenario, and I've already closed 2 other locations, so the other 5 characters should be able to handle the rest of it. It does mean I'm taking a bit more time. It also means if I find nothing but crap spells, then I just wasted my energies. But there are some good spells out there. Deck 4's got some good stuff. There's like a Poison Bolt, which is a 2d12 combat spell. Obviously, it's poison, so a lot of stuff's immune to it, but that's just really, really strong. And then, you know, how many turns will it take him to clear it out? Every spell he picks up is an extra explore. If the first explore isn't a spell, it's an extra explore. You know what? I'm gonna stick around. We'll just pick the fun option here, guys. We'll pick the fun option. Try to find some spells. So Mariziel is, what's her job? What's she? Oh yeah, she's at this place, the horrible place where you have to make dexterity or acrobatics checks to not take damage every time. So let's see if we can close this place. Magic half plate. Don't really need that. Don't pick it up anyhow. We shall explore again, I think. Get a move on here. So there's an ogre. I'm holding an armor, so if I did roll a 1 on my 12, I would have the way to block it. Let's pop this dagger. And let's see, I need an 8 on these 3 dice. That's fine. I could backstab away my masterwork tools because there's no barriers here, so I'm not gonna need the masterwork tools anytime soon. I think I'm gonna do this. Yeah, let's backstab. I'm just gonna recharge these. Mostly just to get rid of them. Alright, that ogre really took some pain, and then that's all we can do. I'm not gonna recharge away my armor, I don't think. Alright, Linny, I don't wanna scry in the temple because it's so unlikely that I actually find a monster there. On the other hand, you know what? It's almost worth it just so that everyone doesn't get sucked over to the temple and loses a card. That's the thing. It'd be so great to find the henchman here. On the other hand, maybe I should just wait until a little bit later. All right, we'll just start exploring and hope the henchman's not near the top of this one. Whoa! Icy hooked hammer plus one. So the d8 plus one. Oh, this is just it looks cool. It's like a really sweet ass picture, but it's just a d8 plus one. It's not very good. Well, I will roll for it. I actually literally, no, I can make it. If I roll like two fours or a four and a three, it's possible. But yeah, it's not actually that great. Let's discard a blessing to explore. It's the villain. Oh my god, this is the worst. It's just the worst when the villain is in the temple because the temple closes automatically, so you don't get any bonus for the fact that killing the villain auto closes it. And it's just hard to kill him as Linny, especially when you don't have your good combat spell. Okay, I guess I shouldn't complain too much. At least I can temp close two locations. This is another side effect of the Harpy Monks, by the way. I might have actually been able to win on. No, I wouldn't have won on the spot, but I could have temp closed a lot more locations. I actually don't even care that much. If she fails to close this, it's really not the end of the world. Like, the villain maybe being here isn't that big of a deal. I don't want to spend resources. And then Ezrin can keep the academy closed. I definitely don't want the villain going into the academy because the whole point of keeping this thing open was to go find the spells. And if I find the villain, the academy auto closes and all the spells get banished anyhow. So he's going to be in one of three places: the peak, the throne room, or that guard tower. No, it's not the guard tower, whatever it's called. So now she has to try to make this constitution check. I don't think it's worth spending the resources here, unfortunately, because I don't have anything that's going to be recharging. Although, oh man, Blessing of the Gods actually would have matched the top blessing, which would have been relevant. But I don't think it's worth it. I think it's better to spend those resources on the actual combat check. If I'd actually kept the orb. Oh, I actually made it. Nice. If I'd kept the orb instead of the stupid Staff of Heaven and Earth, I could have actually got a pretty big bonus against this guy. Well, anyway, she did get really, really lucky getting that plus four bonus, which is nice. And she needs to hit a 12. Ezrin can use swipe to help. Now, normally I wouldn't do this, but right now Ezrin's just at the academy, and there's no weapons or arm or items at the academy anymore. So I'm actually just gonna use this because I don't need the ability of swipe to pick up stuff for him. I do want to use this to help Olenni succeed. So now she needs a 9 on those dice. Alright, Harsk is in a different location, so you can actually use his ability here. Let's recharge away. I don't need both of these weapons. You know what I'm gonna do, actually? Hang on. I'm gonna recharge away a blessing. No, you know what? This scenario doesn't. You don't need armor in this scenario. Nothing deals auto damage except for that one location. Okay, that's it. I'm gonna recharge his armor. And then I'm actually gonna use his sniper power finally for the first time to actually discard the weapon for this bottom effect. Normally you almost never do this, but now it's actually recharged instead of discarded because of the power that he has. So okay, Linny needs a 6 on these 5 dice. We're good. That was a shockingly low roll there. I hope that that Harsk's power works and that his bow is actually recharged instead of discarded, because it'd be really annoying if it wasn't. And yep, he gets the option to recharge it. Good man, good man. And then Ezrin gets the option to recharge it. And I gotta make sure I use my ability now. Wand of Enervation. Oh, that'll be nice next time. Next time. Okay, so got a 11 out of 12 chance of recharging the swipe. Got it, good. Okay. So the villain is gonna be in one of three places, which is pretty decent. We also know that Mauricio's location has a henchman, so that's like an extra fact that we have. And there's always a 50% chance that the villain ends up being underneath, sorry, underneath a henchman. In which case, if we kill the henchman at the other locations, we'll immediately find the villain. I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna scry the mountain peak because it'd be nice to find. It basically, the faster we get through the mountain peak, the better. All right, that was a really good scrying. So now we get two free explorers here. They can only really be undone if the villain is found somewhere else, and no one is here to attempt close the mountain peak. That's a pretty good use of the scry. I am so annoyed that I forgot to put an orb. How did I miss that? I always look through all the items. How did I miss the fact that there was an orb sitting there? I don't watch my videos after I make them, so I'm just curious how I messed that up. Anyway. Harsk's up at the academy. That's definitely not where he wants to be. Harsk, where do you want to be? I guess maybe at the city gate? Although, we could start doing the mountain peak, I guess. Amiri could pull Harsk away. The problem is, I really would rather have Amiri pull away Sela than Harsk, so that she can scout elsewhere than the academy. The scouting at the academy is not that useful. It's just going to put something on the bottom, and it's probably going to be a spell. So, yeah, we'll just have Harsk go to the city gate. That's fine. Okay, Spyglass first. Yap the pixie. What is this? I remember this is something stupid. Oh, well, it's a free explore. Harsk is literally the worst person in the game at picking this thing up. He's only got a 1 in 4 chance with his. Or, sorry, a 3 in 4 chance, which is because his charisma is a D4. But you know what? Screw it. We'll take that 75% chance. If we fail, we fail. Alright, so this is, offers you a chance of making an evasion, but we're just going to go ahead and keep going into this battered chest. I don't really care about getting random items, even though we do have those orbs now in my vault. I just don't care about it enough to spend resources on it, especially because I'm already doing a little bit of funny business, not closing the academy. I want to avoid being too crazy. Bugbear, pretty easy one. So Harsk will be able to take that out, no problemo. And Amiri's up. So we're going to leave the academy. I think it's time to start going for the mountain peak. It's definitely the scariest location. So the sooner I can get rid of it, the better. And right now we just got those monsters on the bottom. All right. It's the henchman. Well, we're fighting the henchman. Obviously, it's good because there's a 1 in 3 chance that the villain is beneath this henchman. I am gonna once again bare fist it. I've got three weapons in my hand, so I don't really mind burying stuff to, get rid of it. And as for Sela, I don't really care about her starting her turn at the mountain peak, so that's fine. And Ezrin, he can move away from there and go back to the academy, so that's fine. Oh wow, I actually got another lucky 1 in 8 roll. That is handy. It will allow him to play strength on Amiri's combat check, which is, non-trivial. Linny, I guess, doesn't need to make this check, but let's just make it anyway. I don't know why not. And then Harsk. Yeah, kind of sucks, but he's gonna get pulled over there as well. I don't know if you have to do the check to avoid burying a card as if the place is closed. I can't remember. Okay, let's bury the non-magical weapon. And Ezrin is allowed to play spells, so let's play strength. So Amiri needs a 6 on those dice. That's a little bit loose to make this roll here without helping. So why don't we play a Pharasma Blessing, get a couple extra dice, and really secure this pot. Okay, now let's close the location definitely. So Sela has the Blessing of Wisdom. This is an auto success now, thanks to the checks not getting any harder. And I could have used a Blessing of Torag, which would have been recharged, but I like the guarantee there. And Father Xantus only works on myself, right? Yeah, Amiri's actually not been discarding anything. She's just been burying a whole bunch of stuff. She's got, well, just two cards buried. I guess it's not really that crazy. Anyway, she's here. So I have a choice. I can either move her somewhere and then bring Sela over to get an extra scout, or I can use this ability. I could stay here and use this ability to examine the top card of an open deck. So Either way, I guess I'm getting scouting information, but by moving Sela over, I also move the thing to the bottom. So I think for her to stay there doesn't make too much sense. Okay, let's see. I forget what we found at the throne room. I forget if there was a monster there or not. Shoot. Well, we're going there. If I mess up, I mess up. Oh no, it doesn't matter, right? Because that was undone by the villain. Yeah, the villain ended up changing places, so any of the early scoutings were undone. I'm not going to use Ezrin's power down here because I already know the next card. It's the Wand of Enervation, so there's no reason to watch that graphic happen. Okay, Sela, start over. Slashing Blade. Ugh, Jesus, hate this thing. Okay, so I think we're going to have Mariziel come over to take care of it, but Sela's definitely not going to futz with that. Yeah, this place is terrible for her. The place she's at is terrible because of the slashing blade, so she's only got one place to go, and that is what is this? Now, this is the city gate, not to be confused with the guard tower. Right. Okay, Horus was gonna do this, but that's fine. Hello, can I explore? Oh my god. Yeah, this is the bugs. The bugs are a little bad in this adventure. She really just cannot explore this bugbear. It just ain't happening. It was like lit up, but as soon as I pressed the examine button, it like unlit. All right, what if I like try to cast something and then like take it back? I don't think it'll actually let me take it back though. Yeah, no, it's not letting me explore this bugbear, so I could just lose a turn. Yeah. All right, screw it. I'm not gonna dick around anymore. So we're gonna explore and scout the bugbear again. And pass the turn. That was sad. All right, so here we go. Back to Ezrin. This academy could have already been closed, but hey, it was just made worth it by this incendiary cloud because this is a really good spell. For the rest of the turn, it makes all your members of your party get an extra 2d4 and the fire trait to checks against monsters in combat. The real question here is whether I want to spend a resource to secure this or take the 1 in 12 chance of failure. I'll take the 1 in 12 chance of failure to keep things interesting, but if I fail, that would be very sad. Oh, Jesus, that was really close. Okay, so we get an extra explore here. I do have to bury something. I'm not that interested in this Amulet of Life. There's nothing in this scenario that would make me think I need it, so we're just gonna keep on trucking. Duelist, this is pretty much crappy. I mean, if I pick it up, I do get an extra explore. I could use agility to pick it up, or to try to pick it up. I still have to roll a 5. I don't think I have any free blessings here. I've got eloquence, which would help charisma, which is the same exact issue. Man, these stupid favors. I almost want to just trash them so they just don't. Oh, wait a minute. No, hold on. I'm missing this. Hang on. This is the Torag keyword, which means that Amiri can actually recharge this Blessing of Torag. Oh my god, I've been missing that this whole time. That's actually kind of annoying. You have to look at those up close to see what keyword they have. So like this has the Torag keyword, so the regular Blessings of Torag will recharge with it. Okay, well now it's actually worth it. So now I can just go ahead and play agility. And so I have a decent shot of picking up this duelist. On the nose! Alright, everything made a difference there. And now I'm going to play the Duelist to keep exploring, hopefully finding more spells here. Sagacity. Alright, well, I don't want a second copy of Sagacity, but it is good that it gives me a free explore. And I will just actually go ahead and bury it. Consecration. This one's interesting. So if I pick it up, I do get an extra explore. Oh, I should have kept Sagacity. What was I thinking? It would help me pick up divine spells. Oh, jeez, I'm stupid. But anyway, this doesn't. Ezrin can't really do anything with this. It's sort of like a one-use get bonus turns. So I would never even keep this spell. I don't think it's that good. But spending resources to pick it up just to get an extra explore is kind of silly, I think, because I might as well have those characters use those blessings on their own turn to get an extra explore. So we'll just roll this and fail. Oh my god, that is a lot of eights rolled on a d8 in this scenario. Definitely some lucky stuff happening. We're gonna go ahead and bury this because I'm not gonna use it. Ezrin has no blessings, and I'm not gonna hand it off to anyone else anytime soon. Goblin Commando. All right, that's fine. So we're gonna bury or discard the. Actually, yeah, the wand. Don't really want that wand. And then for the combat check, I think Acid Arrow should get the job done. Yes, that is an auto success. All right, so now in this place, there are two spells left and a barrier. So the worst is if the barrier's in the middle. That's the worst, because if the barrier's in the middle, I find a spell, pick it up, find the barrier, and then my turn stops, and I have to spend one more turn later to pick up the last spell. But as long as the barrier's up front or the barrier's last, assuming I pick up my spells, of course, I should get through the Academy on Ezrin's next turn. I'm not using my hero power here to look at the not top part of my deck, because I already know what it is. It's the Wand of Enervation. So I get it now to help other people out. We got Augury, which is unfortunately not that useful, at least on Ezrin's next turn, but the turn after it could be nice. All right, Mariziel's up. Where can she go? Oh yeah, she's still got this location, this courtyard, all carved out just for her. Short sword plus one. That's definitely not good. Man, we are rolling some hot eights here. That is crazy town. Yeah, let's keep going. I'm gonna keep exploring. Try to get through this courtyard. It's the Harpy Monk. So here's the thing about the Harpy Monk. Everybody's gonna get sucked in, which means Mariziel's not gonna be able to do her backstab. However, to hit a 16, I think with this Venomous Dagger plus some blessings, she should be fine, especially because she's got that new power that allows her to play blessings on her dexterity check and recharge them instead of discarding them. Now, I've heard that that power was bugged, and the blessings end up being banished instead of recharged, which is a pretty big difference, but we'll see. I'm gonna try it out. That should be enough to beat this thing. Okay, I'm gonna use the medallion or the armor if I fail this, so I just don't care about it. And I'm lucky that that happens before the Harpy pulls everyone in. That would have been sick if first everybody has to make this check and then they have to make the check for the courtyard. That would have been a massive amount of damage dealt to the whole party. So yeah, there's no way that everybody's making these wisdom checks, so I'm just gonna not care about it and just let everybody fail. Actually, it's kind of cool. It does pull away whoever was at the mountain peak. Oh no, the mountain peak's already closed. Never mind, what am I talking about? Okay. Beep, 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 beep. Ooh, a seven that time. Man, Ezrin is rolling hot. This dude is hot shit. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and let's see. Should we use the Wand of Enervation? No, I think we'll use the Orb of Storms though. I think that's fine. So let's give her an extra couple of D4s. Mariziel. Oh, I can't use weapons, right? Because I didn't. What was I thinking? Oh, jeez, I'm an idiot. I totally thought I was like, oh, I'm gonna use a dagger. There's obviously no way that I'm going to. Okay, that's fine. So we'll use this for two extra D8s. And Poog. Let's Poog it up here. Give her an extra plus three. Maybe this was the right time to use the Wand of Enervation. Okay, let's use the Blessing of Yabba Dabba Doo because it recharges. So I need 13 on these six dice. How good are those odds? Well, that's like an expected result of what, 9, 18, 23. It's 10 above the expected. Yeah, this is fine. So we got the monk down. Let's close this place up. And she doesn't have a blessing anymore to help with that. That was kind of silly of me. Any rechargeable things? Nope. Actually, we're really just low on blessings in general. Shoot. This could actually be a fail. I mean, it's not that likely that you would, like, fail 2d12 hitting a 4, but it's possible. Okay, luckily nothing terrible happened. And we closed off the toughest location of the scenario, so now we're doing pretty good here. Let's recharge that orb if possible. Got a lot of things that are a recharge of 10 check, meaning that Ezrin always got that 1 in 12 chance of failing, just to keep things exciting. Now, where the hell is Linny gonna go? She can actually go to the academy, but she's not bad at closing the throne room. I mean, charisma is not a skill that she has. She just has like a D8 for it or something, but that's better than average. What is her charisma? Yeah, it's a D8. And then she has her animal to help. Yeah, I think this is fine. Let's just go there and make some progress instead of wasting time at the academy. Oh, yeah, it's Slashing Blade. Mariziel was supposed to go here. Whoops. Well, this is. Oh, God! Oh, it's that bug. That's the bug. If you examine the location, then you cannot explore it afterwards. This is so irritating. I can't even play a blessing to like explore. To keep exploring, it's just like stuck. You know what I'm gonna try? I'm gonna just try quitting. I'm gonna try going back to the main menu and I'm gonna go back into the scenario. I already lost one turn with Sela for no reason whatsoever, so let's not handicap myself anymore and see if just resetting things lets me take that turn. That is a really annoying bug though, because it's like you want to examine what's there. Anyway, oh wait, hang on. I could actually use the Staff of Heaven and Earth. Oh, right, but you have to discard a spell. Freaking ridiculous. You know what? I'm gonna do it. Whatever. Sure, I lose my cure spell, but wait. Hang on. With this animal, how hard is it really? It's. I need to get a six, and I'm kind of running low on blessings. Alright, we're gonna do this. This is fine. So, what I'll do is I will use this piece of crap and then auto succeed at the slashing blade. And then I could actually use my toad to get back the cure, but no, I'll just. Wait a minute, hang on. If I actually, like, fight a monster, I'm in pretty rough shape. Eh, screw it. Let's discard that. Keep going. So, we're gonna recharge this. This thing is a pretty crappy weapon. And it does require weapon proficiency, which I think Linny was forced to get, was she not? Yes, she has weapon proficiency, so she could use it. This actually wouldn't be a bad pickup if I could get lucky enough to get a five on those two dice, which I was. So now, as she keeps exploring, she can actually fight. And I will go ahead and discard this and see what we can get. Let's pick up this armor. I don't know if I'm actually going to use it, but let's take it in case I do find a monster or something so I can block the damage. And now I could play the toad to get back cure, but the funny thing is I don't actually have that much stuff to cure, so there's no real reason to do it. I don't want to lose my last animal though. So what I'm gonna do here is I'm just gonna discard the armor and then draw and hopefully find another animal. Did not. Okay. Harsk. Yeah, I guess we're just gonna go to the city gate. He's better at closing that than the other place, which he has no chance of closing, and I'm not gonna examine this location. Because I just want to explore without having to quit. Alright, let's reveal the longbow. Almost auto succeed. 1 in 48 chance of failure, I think. So let's keep that going. And we're doing really good on time. I'm not going to explore again with Harsk. Let's just keep it going. Boots of Elvenkind. Alright, it's pretty crappy. If the boots could auto succeed at acrobatics, they'd actually be okay. The problem is. Can I view this location and like nope, I can't. The problem is that they succeed at stealth and they add a die to acrobatics. Or do I have that memorized wrong? I might actually be wrong about that. I'm not sure. Well, anyway, Amiri, yeah, she can close this place, not the other place. So I guess we'll see when we encounter these things, which I'm not going to examine. Yeah, it succeed at stealth, boost acrobatics. If it was the other way around, it would actually be a good item because the acrobatics checks get really crazy later on and really useful. But as it is, it's just shit. Alright, so let's discard a blessing. I want to use Father Xantus because I just want to get him out of my hand. Keep going through my deck. Can't explore anymore. So, Papa Z. Oh, this is just a waste. What do I really have in here that I want to get? Oh, blessings. Yeah, I'm going to do this. This is just like a total waste, but yeah, really, really big waste of healing. But in this case, you know, I'm just doing so well in the scenario. I just want to keep going through my deck, basically. So I'm gonna go ahead and pull Sela somewhere for some scouting knowledge. Let's do, I guess, this location because I forget what's happening at the other one. So might as well do the place where I know it'll actually be helpful. Harpy monk, who wants to fight a harpy monk? Is it you, Sela? Do you want to fight a harpy monk? Oh, brother. Let's see, Harsk won't help you. We got an aide that can help you. We got Incendiary Cloud that can help you. Alright, you know what? Okay, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna play Incendiary Cloud now because I won't be able to play it later after failing the check. This is a little trick you can use with these display spells. You can play them when you're not in combat, which allows you to essentially get more than one spell played. So now we're gonna go ahead and fight this Harpy Monk. Sure, I'll flip a card just to see if I can maybe make this check. Not even close. Even sagacity would not have helped. All right, Ezrin is going to fail this, but we don't care anymore. I can actually do the Wand of Enervation to really help against the Harpy Monk, but I might as well save that against the villain. Although against the villain, we're going to have like all the bonuses flying down. On the other hand, we're actually getting a little bit low on blessings as a party, so there might not actually be that many bonuses flying down when we fight against the villain. So yeah, I will go ahead and save the Wand of Enervation because I think that Sela can barefist this Harpy Monk without the wand. Okay, so first of all, we're gonna go ahead and flip a card. And then play Blessing of Gorm, I think, from Amiri, who's hale as a horse. Does anybody have that dexterity blessing? Oh, there's this aid that I wanted to use. Yep. So now we need a 10 on these five dice. That's two per die. We should be pretty safe. There we go. And what's nice is that we're still gonna have the Incendiary Cloud to help kill the bandit henchmen that Sela now needs to close or needs to kill to close the location. And the bandit henchmen are not totally trivial anymore because now they I don't need this many swords, and I don't need stealth or survival in this scenario. Because now the Bandit Henchmen, do get a bonus for the scenario, or it's not the scenario, for the adventure deck that they're coming from. They started out at 8 in adventure in the first introductory scenarios, and then they're up to 12 now, plus 4 because we're in adventure deck 4. Anyway, we charge a card, and wait a minute. What did be? I played that last time. Well, now I don't even want to play it. I swear I played that last time though. Did we not see this? Did we not see me play that thing? Oh my god, the bugs. I've been a pretty big defender of Obsidian, but yeah, these are some pretty rough bugs. All right, I'm just gonna flip a card. This is fine. I don't really care if I lose my armor or whatever else is in there. It's mostly blessings and spells in her deck, so it's fine if I lose something. Okay, so this should close now. And there's the villain. Okay, so let me think. Let me take a look at what's going on here. So we got this one place. She needs a charisma or diplomacy 6. Oh, and then of course the academy. Oh God. Okay, so we'll just leave that villain alone, I think, for the time being. Wait a minute. You know what? Hang on a minute. I actually want to do this. I'm not gonna need eloquence. Wait a minute. Am I really not gonna need eloquence? It's gonna help close that charisma place. No, I don't wanna bury that. I was thinking of burying it to heal, but she's fine, and plus she has a major cure. So we'll just leave everything alone. There's her major cure. Okay, so Ezrin got haste, which is good because that will allow him to explore more than once. In fact, I think augury is not that useful anymore. I'm gonna augury, and we're gonna go ahead and say spells. Pit trap. That's kind of annoying. Well, let's see. We'll do the acid arrow first. Then detect evil is a divine, so it's not guaranteed that I pick it up. But the acid arrow is a guaranteed pickup. Okay, toxic cloud, that'll be nice against the villain. So if the cards actually work this time, I'll be able to play both incendiary cloud and toxic cloud before we fight the villain. So yeah, that was recharging augury. Now we find the acid arrow, auto pick it up. Then we get an extra explore. I don't actually need the acid arrow. Then we get the divine evil. And this would be nice to pick up, but I don't. Yeah, all right. We'll do this. We'll just make sure the academy gets closed this turn. Play a couple of or we'll play two dice on it with the wisdom blessing to get closer to my 200 gold daily challenge. I don't need detect evil itself, and then we're gonna fight this pit trap, which is not my favorite. This thing does not banish upon being used, so maybe I should have saved that wisdom blessing for this. Oh God. Well, crap. So crud. I actually do need to spend like all of my blessings here. That might have been stupid. Oh yeah, this one could have been used to get the boon. And then I could have saved the wisdom blessing to get two dice against this pit trap. Crap. Well, whatever. If I fail because of a bad roll, I can try again next time. Luckily, I did not fail. So the location's empty. Now we're gonna go ahead and close it. And we still, oh, I've only used half the time of the scenario. So I guess I'm pretty happy with that choice to not close the academy because we did get one really good spell. And if you get even one good spell, then it's like kind of all worth it. Okay. So here, I think I'm gonna just put Mauricio here and have her use the Crown of Charisma to auto close the throne room. If I explore once, there's a chance I might get like a useful weapon or something. Let's guess we'll use the spyglass just to see what's there. So detect evil is not very good, but mass cure is quite good. This lets you pick a character, and that character it has to be someone other than you. But that character gets 1d4 plus 1 cards, and then you also get 1d4 plus 1 cards. So it's like a cure on yourself and a cure on someone else. So it's really, really strong. Obviously, she's not going to encounter that because she cannot pick it up. But conveniently, Linny is next. So yeah, why don't we do this actually? Recharge an item to draw a card. Dog! And yeah, let's try to pick up this thing. It's going to be tough even with my animal because I need to roll a 4. I don't want to fail this, so I'm just gonna throw an extra die out just to make sure I pick this up. In fact, there's a 50-50 chance I would have failed it because my D4 was a 1 and one of my D10s was a 2. Whew. Okay, so let's go ahead and cast Mass Cure because why not? Oh, this is a berry? Oh no, it was, oh god, no, it's asking me what I want to bury, right? I want to bury this battle axe, right? I actually want to cast the cure. Yeah, this is a regular roll. It's not a bury spell. It's a regular discard slash chance to recharge spell. Okay, so there's the one for Mariseal, there's the one for Aleni. God, that is such a good card. All right, so now we're going to try to recharge it. This is where actually having that cat wouldn't be bad, because these recharge checks get really crazy. Oh, the cat would have made me succeed at this. The cat is this stupid thing where it's like you get a plus two to your chance check to recharge a spell. There's now no longer a reason for me to keep exploring, even though I could have, because I might as well just close that location and fight the villain. In fact, is Harsk good enough? I think Harsk can actually take this villain on. Oh, I forgot to play the Incendiary Cloud and the Toxic Cloud. Oops. Well, let's go ahead and recharge that to close that place. We're done closing everything up. There's no trickery here, just the villain. Gonna make a fortitude check. I don't think I care about this fortitude check that much. Again, any resources that I spend making the fortitude check, I could just spend on the actual combat check. And everyone has to make this check, so everyone's gonna have harder checks for the rest of the turn. But it doesn't actually matter because Harsk is the only one who actually has to make a check. He's the one who has to try to take this guy down. So we're gonna discard this thing, play the blessing, play the ally. This is pretty good actually for Harsk. Then we're gonna do the Wand of Enervation, which did turn out to be useless. Oh, God. I forgot that you have to play the wand first. Well, now it's gonna be super dramatic because we're gonna discard this bow, and then this blessing, and then the Black Arrow Ranger. Yeah! And then we're gonna play the Incendiary Cloud. Oh, you know what? He's immune to poison, so I couldn't have used Toxic Cloud anyways. And then we're gonna play this aid, and then we're gonna play this other double die blessing. This is like the most glorious moment that our Dwarven Rangers ever had. He is gonna wreck this black monk by over twice the check, and that's a wrap. So thanks everybody for watching the video. I hope you enjoyed it. Please like and or subscribe. And now we're gonna have a very exciting moment. So story-wise, the loot that we're, picking up here is what's allowing us to continue exploring the Fortress of the Stone Giants or whatever. But mechanically-wise, we just get an item, which is a really, really sweet item, and we're gonna see that in a moment while we build up our decks. Hopefully I'm not a friggin' idiot and I like don't forget to put it in my deck. Oh yeah, I forgot this game gives you like other stuff. So shields are just bad. I hate it. I hate to say it, but they're just bad. It's like, oh, it is kind of cool that I can like, reveal it to resist damage, and there's like, there's gonna be times in the game where there is, elemental damage coming at me, but it's like, if I get hit really, really hard by a monster, then I really just want to be able to like bury the card to block all the damage. And with shields, you just can't. Also, randomly, you can't play them if, well, not randomly, but thematically, you can't play them if you use a two-handed weapon, which is just like an extra bit of a nuisance. So I don't know if I'm gonna keep that. No, it is tempting, but we'll see. Breastplate of fire resistance, not bad, although I think she might already have better stuff. Does Ezreal get like a spell? Oh, fuck, this thing. God, I hate that thing. It's such a trap card. It looks so good, but having to discard spells is really bad. Even for Ezreal, who has a lot of spells, it's just bad. Ooh, this one's nice. It's good in this adventure, although you know what? Okay, so if you look at it, you get like a lot of dice if you're fighting against giants, but once we're done fighting giants, it's a d4 plus 1 plus a d4. Yeah, I don't think this is actually very good, so I might not keep that. And then I guess she's gonna get the actual loot. Yep, the Emerald Codex. This thing is fantastic. Okay, so you bury the card, and you draw three divine spells from the vault, and you put them in front of you. And those three divine spells are considered to be cards in your hand. You can play them, basically anytime you could normally play a card, except that they're not actually taking up any hand space, and they just sit there. So it's like you get three spells from the box that you can use sometime later in that scenario, and you do that every single scenario. So the thing about the Emerald Codex is you don't have to give it to a divine person, because the only time it really matters for the player who uses the codex to have the divine skill is if they draw a cure card. No, not a cure card, I'm sorry. If they draw a combat card. Otherwise, cure cards, any other buffs, someone who's not divine trained can use them just as well as a divine caster. So I'm probably going to give this to Linny because she is carrying that stupid Staff of Heaven and Earth. But later on, if Linny gets like an orb, I might actually give the codex to someone else. And what does Harsk get as his bonus here? Lesser Bolstering Armor. You draw a card after recharging it to reduce I don't think that's as good as his loot armor from before, which gives him just like a plus one to any dexterity check on a reveal. So the special stuff wasn't that good here, but that's fine because in the real game you weren't gonna get it anyway. Okay, so do I want to keep this thing? It is nice to sometimes, you know, be able to block that elemental damage. Acid, cold, electricity, or fire, and of course combat as well, huh? You can recharge it at the end of the turn. All right, fine, we'll do it. This is only just blocks range combat damage. When's Amiri ever gonna get hit full blast by something? Let's try it out. Let's be different and daring. All right, she has an extra weapon because Amiri gave her one of her bastard swords. Let's put that back in its rightful owner's hand, and then yeah, I think, well, the magic full plate. Yeah, that the magic full plate's not as good as these fire resistance breastplates. So yeah, I will actually go ahead and keep that. Okay, Ezreal got a lot of spells. We're gonna keep the incendiary cloud, and I think at this moment I'm actually gonna, if I can scroll, get rid of invisibility. The reason for this is simply that invisibility is good as like a just in case card. Oh, sorry, wiping my nose, I have a cold. It's a good just in case card, like because later on there's gonna be monsters that you can't like play spells against. But my strategy is if I find those monsters, I'm gonna bare fist them. And I'm gonna just play blessings, I'm gonna use Harsk and those orbs and whatever to just bare fist those monsters to death. That way, I don't have to keep this card in my deck that pretty much never does anything. I think I have like a lot of extra acid arrows now. Yeah, I don't want any of these anymore. And I don't want two copies of Sagacity. So, yeah, I think this is actually looking pretty good. We got a lot of helping spells for the team, enough combat spells for myself. What is that? Like two scorching rays and a lightning bolt and a swipe. That should be enough for his giant hand size. Staff Heaven Earth, I hate you, go die. And then do I keep this wand of scorching ray? I don't think so. There's only one good item I think that's actually a good combat item. I forget what deck it's in. It might even not be like till deck 5, or maybe it's in deck 3. I don't know. It's the Necklace of Missiles or something like that. That one's a banish, and you roll like 3d12 or something crazy. And if you're trained in Arcane, you can make a pretty tough recharge check to recharge it instead of banishing it, or discard it instead of banishing it or something. So that one's good just because the numbers are so high. This thing is not worth a spot, I don't think. And then the Duelist is obviously garbage. And then he picked up a blessing. How did he get this blessing? How did Ezreal get that blessing? I do not know how that happened, but okay. So Sela's missing a blessing, so she's gonna have to pick it up. Okay, Mariziel doesn't want that. So the problem with the, oh, you know what? I actually have a dagger plus one. All right, I guess we'll get rid of it. It is strictly better than a dagger plus one, so I guess we can delay the need to think about that. Okay, now here we have a bit of a tricky one. No, we don't. Corrosive Splash is garbage, so we're gonna get rid of it. And then keep that mass cure now. And get rid of magic leather armor. Get rid of this stupid Staff of Heaven and Earth, which I hate. And the lesser bolstering armor, we decided it wasn't as good. Yap the pixie. Yap the pixie. Oh my god. He just goes yap, yap, yap. One thing I think you could do here, if you wanted to in the situation, is keep the consecration. It does give you some extra turns in the scenario. I actually might have kept it if I was in my heroic playthrough because getting extra turns can be really essential. But in this game, where it's not really almost ever going to be an issue, I don't want to keep a spell around that does nothing. Just like for the same reason that I got rid of invisibility, I don't want to have a permanent card in my deck taking up space doing nothing, where I could put in something that's, you know, more fun and more interesting as like a just in case something really bad happens. If something really bad happens, then it happens. I'll deal with it or I'll lose the scenario, but then all the rest of the time I'm going to be happy that I'm not doing it. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that'll do it for this video. For real now, thanks for watching. Please like and or subscribe, and I'll see you again soon. Take care.